All right, so Dylan Johnson made another video about strength training this last week, and I decided to I want to make a video about actually how good strength training is. So we're going to go through the studies he references quickly, and then really focus on actually how it impacts your training and how you can structure it so that maybe it doesn't impact your training, or if it's even worth it. So anyway, on lots of different videos, Dylan Johnson mentions lots of different studies, however, and I couldn't get access to all of them, but we're just going to go through some of them. So this is the first one that I found. Well, he's said, which is the effect of strength training on lactate threshold endurance performance. So as you can see here, we're just going to read the abstract very quickly. So 12-week strength training, but immediately all men, so not great. 18 healthy untrained. Okay, that's again not too useful. And then it says there was a 5% increase in cycling at time to exhaustion at 75% of peak threshold, peak VO2, which is basically threshold. But it says like VO2 didn't really change. There was significant reduction in plasma lactate concentration at all relative exercise intensities. And then basically, I guess the thing is that what realistically has happened is that they've either done like endurance or endurance and strength. And obviously, if these people are untrained, they've got highest training stimulus, they are going to get better. The rest of it is all strength. So I don't know how useful this data is unless you're untrained. I think it's best to ignore it. We're now going to go into the next one, which actually I have the whole paper for, and it's pretty interesting stuff. So this was done at maximal strength training, improving cycling economics in competitive cyclists. So this is good. So we'll just read through it quickly, but you can see here, the purpose of the present study was to investigate the effect of maximal strength training on cycling economy at 7% of maximal oxygen consumption. So again, that's a round threshold. Obviously it depends per person, and then they talk about all the rest of it. So if we actually look, it's 12 men, 4 women, so better, got a split of genders, which is always interesting. It's very hard, often quite hard, for people to design studies so that men and women can both do it, but it's good when they do it, because I think otherwise it slightly devalues the study. But anyway, all they did was 4 sets of 4 of half squats, which is basically just a normal squat, but obviously going to like half your leg compression. So pretty decent, because it's minimal strength time, which is something we're going to get onto in a minute. And what the results are, obviously your 1 rep max increase, that's irrelevant. That doesn't affect cycling. And then RFD, which is rate of force development, again, 16%, it goes up. Your CE, which again, we said here, is your cycling efficiency, cycling economy, sorry, is what goes up by 5%. And your work efficiency goes up 5%. And time to exhaustion at pre-intervention maximal aerobic power goes up 70%. So that's pretty good. Like your MAP is what most people would say is their RAM test. So that is pretty impressive, actually. I think this study shows, actually, I can't really fault it too badly, because it just shows that you literally need to go to the gym and do 4x4 of squats and it'll increase. But again, we'll go into the methods. The subjects we don't really care about. The procedures is the important part. So this is all the testing, which again, I don't think is too useful, because it's just so that you can recreate the study and you can really dive down into exactly how they tested it. But suffice to say, it's robust enough that we don't need to worry about it. You can see here they're training on heart rate, so always interesting. But what they were saying is every time the subject managed to do 5 reps during a set, 2.5 kilos were added. So again, progressive overload. The 70% threshold was selected on the basis of minimum training response expected. And most of the time they did their three sets a week. Now, I think this study is really good, basically, because it's very minimal hours, and this is the point we're going to get into at the end of the video, which is how this is applicable to you. But I think this study, I can't really fault too much. Like, obviously, it isn't mad improvements. Like, I think the 17% like MAP is pretty mad. But I think you can see here, so it increased the maximum aerobic power by 62 seconds or 17%. So I think that was like what they did, is just got them their MAP, and then they said just, I assume they did the same test and then just kept them there to see how much longer they could do. But yeah, what they did say, there was no changes found in present study regarding body weight, O2 max. So body weight's obviously a big one. You're not going to gain weight. That's fine. Basically, VO2 or wattage of lactate threshold. So again, your thresholds are not going to increase, but it looks like the proportion of what you can do is you can hold it for longer, which I guess is the point, is that it's cycling efficiency, which is pretty useful. And you do train a lot. And it's 8 weeks as well, which isn't too bad. So the practical applications, this is always what we're looking for. So they're basically saying that it's very good, minimal time, and you should do it. And I think I can't really fault it too much. This is a lit review done by Ronestad, who is like a classic bloke. He basically almost invented 3015s. But if we look at this, he's done another study, and this is more interesting because this is endurance. This is, again, is in trained cyclists, and 5-minute performance does increase. But this one, they only do, to be fair, like 4 exercises a week. So if we look here, they list the 4 exercises, which is a half squat, leg press, One leg hip flexion, which is basically like a lunge, and calf raises, which is the toe raise. And you can see here, like, the VO2 max does go up with endurance plus strength, or just endurance. You can look at like heart rate max, doesn't really matter. RPE is a relevant scale. But if you look at VO2 max, that's obviously absolute, but if you do it per, percentage goes 66.8 to 69, these people go 65.9 to 69.8. So you can see they both did increase, but endurance did actually go up higher, which is always weird. But then if you look at the actual results, the max power that they did went up quite a lot. I don't know why they haven't done that in, but anyway, then if we look at this, the percentage of maximum heart rate, again, this is just their training. So you can basically see most of their training is done at a pretty easy intensity if you want to recreate this. And then if we look at, in the third test, what they did is they rode at 44% of W max, so that's probably like zone two. And then what they did, if you look at this, it'd be about, 180 watts-ish here. And then this is because, as they said in the study, basically most people do less than 150 watts during a race. And if we go down here to the, this is all of, and then the 5 minute all out time trial was basically what they did. And they said their numbers were increasing from like 380 to 400. So pretty ideal. But the question is though, really at the end of the day, so this is what they were saying here. This is the one rep max, but the question is, so it's a bit of a long video, but like, is it worth it for you? So obviously the gains are pretty significant. And if we actually look at like, the VO2 max, so both ENS, so endurance and strength, increased during the thing. The use of VO2 max was 3% for ENS, 6% for endurance, with no statistical difference between the groups. That's true. But that was also because there was some body mass changes as well. But I guess what their main point is to do with the fact that the 5%, the 5 minute power at the end of the day, which we'll get to, increased. So here we go. There was no change in the endurance, which is, I guess, the important thing. But anyway, so basically, the whole point of this video is it worth doing strength training? I think it is, but I think you do have to realize that these studies are in an ideal world where you can train as much as you do now, but then just add the strength on, which for some people isn't possible. Because, you know, I was saying earlier on this study, it was like, oh, it's only 20 minutes, you know, to do the 4x4. But you have to get to the gym, you have to change, you have to go to the, then do the session, which is 20 minutes, then have a shower and then come home or go to work or whatever you're going to do. It's like, do you have that time? And is that going to take away from your cycling? And I think the other thing is the periodization of it, is that I don't understand when it's doing. So if we look at this study here, if we go back up to the actual methodology, what you'll see is that they were encouraged to perform strength training the first session of the day, which obviously they're going to see it like, is like mainly focusing on strength. But then if you want to get your cycling numbers as good as possible, you can't really do that. So it's very hard to like fit it all in, which is why I think having it, obviously this is a 12-week study, which is pretty good, but I do think it would be more interesting to see like a whole periodized section of like how from, you know, the base season all the way to racing, how you can maintain the strength and endurance training and then see what the results are versus strength, or strength at versus strength and endurance, but make sure it's the same time. And then that would be a lot more interesting, and the same like workload, if you could somehow quantify strength training into like TSS and then use that, it would be very interesting. I don't think you can, but I think that's something to look at. To conclude, is it a magic bullet? I don't think it is. I think it does help, but I don't think it's like as essential as Don Johnson makes it out to be necessarily, because obviously a lot of pros don't do it. And a lot of the gains you get are really early on, so you can basically sack it off after like 8 weeks often, or just do a little bit of strength training here or there. But I think the other thing to take away from this study is that you don't need to do like 2 hours in the gym. You can just do 4x4 squats and you're going to get a lot of gains. So anyway, cheers for watching. Hope you did enjoy. We'll see you in the next one.